where Kristen is now the director, and I left her, you know, a different mess than what I had when I started. Always the evolution, right? So, but when I started off as an animal care technician, which really was a euthanasia technician, is what I learned the first day on the job. At the time, we were taking in 30,000 animals and killing pretty much all of them. We didn't have adoption staff, but we had 6 staff allocated to killing animals for 3 shifts. And so I unfortunately was on that, so I really understand what it's like being there from the beginning and trying to figure out how do you change. But over a 10-year period, we made small changes, some really big changes, to eventually become a center that's more life-saving oriented. And so a lot of my experience comes from, you know, volunteer programs, rescue programs, medical programs, and sheltering programs. And the next phase is what Kristen's working on, which is animal protection and taking everything to that next level of life-saving and having it become a resource center. So I think it's going to be a really great conversation today.
Good afternoon. Ellen asked me yesterday to do this one, so.
No.
So I am actually not going to talk about Williamson County Regional Animal Shelter because we actually really started out about 50%. So I'm going to talk about the first shelter that I managed, and that was in a city that I was in. And if any of you in my morning talk, it's because I was the EMS director in the city, and my dog got picked up late one night. I had no idea it would go to an animal shelter that late because there shouldn't have been anybody working, and they killed it the next morning. And I found out because I worked at the police station and I could go back through dispatch logs and finally traced it back, and then they tried to cover it up. And so I realized how broken that system was. I couldn't even fathom. I had been out there a couple of times with the police lieutenant that I was friends with, and just seeing the mess that was out there, like 4 or 5 dogs in a little kennels, and there's bloody diarrhea on the walls, I remember. And so I decided, after I got over my grief, which I don't think you ever recover from that, that nobody should have to live through that. My dog had tags, multiple tags with phone numbers. So nobody should have to live through that. So I thought there has to be a better way to do animal sheltering. So I knew I couldn't take over the animal shelter right away. I asked, and they were like, no, the police chief, he's not going to give it up. And so I started a volunteer group, Cause for Paws, and we started working and volunteering at the shelter. I had access to some of the records. They literally adopted out 0 animals, 0. They came in, if they weren't reclaimed, they were killed in a gas chamber. And so we went out there after work. I cleaned tons of kennels. We went out there on the weekends because the thing was they didn't have an animal control officer to work the weekends, so they killed them all on Friday, so nobody had to go in on their Saturday or Sunday and clean the kennels. So all of us volunteers went out there. We actually got keys to the shelter. They just let us come and go because we basically did all the work out there. And so about 4 or 5 months after that, I convinced the city manager that that department needs to be under me, under EMS and with EMS. And so I ran both departments. And I had no clue about animal diseases, animal welfare, how animal shelters were supposed to run. Zero. I had zero knowledge. I was a dog owner. That's all I knew. So I had to learn everything, but I just knew there had to be a better way. So I found Fix It Austin and started downloading all their materials. And then I heard about Nathan Winograd and started going to conferences. And then, you know, really started doing a lot of off-site adoptions and different things. So we changed that shelter around to an adoption shelter instead of a kill shelter.
I'm Carl Bailey. I'm a police officer with Sickleville Police Department. And in 2011, our chief came to me and said that the police department wants to operate the animal shelter, and he wanted me to run it. And like Cheryl, I had no experience running an animal shelter. I've been a cop forever. But I went out to Google and learned as much as I could. I knew that when we took over, and he wanted us to run it, wanted me and another police officer to run it, that killing animals like they were killing animals there, which 50 to 60 a month was not going to work for us. It would just, you know, push us over the edge psychologically. Walk in, I really didn't have too much of a plan just to stop killing, and didn't know how we were going to get it out, but we kind of winged it, and it was a day-to-day learning experience. We shut the gas chamber down the first day we walked in, stopped using that. That wasn't going to be in operation anymore. And we just started doing adoption events, building volunteer programs, building partnerships and with different groups. And our local school had a veterinary technician program, and we partnered with them so they could foster some of the animals while they recovered. And the first year we saved 97% of our animals. So. We're still doing it today.
Thanks. My name's Rebecca Gwen. I'm with Lifeline Animal Project. We operate the county shelters in Atlanta, Fulton and DeKalb County. We took over as a private contractor in those two shelters. The time we took over DeKalb is about a 60% save rate. We had partnered with DeKalb over the years and had a very robust community cat program, and I attribute that to the to getting to 60% at that shelter. The other shelter of Fulton County, Fulton County is a city, county of about 1 million people. It encompasses most of the city of Atlanta. They had a 35% save rate. That shelter had been built in 1978 and historically was closed to the public. So it was never, by the time we got there, it had been open for adoptions, but people still didn't really know about it. I think the within the first year of Fulton, we were over 50%. That shelters that hovers between 85% and 90% now, as does the DeKalb shelter. I think the thing that we did most, and the thing that I see in any shelter that we've been asked to consult with, is that there's not much of an investment in life saving if it's a shelter that's below 50%. Can imagine the city of Atlanta, there were, it's a pretty big metropolitan area. It has the busiest airport in the world, and that's probably why you've all been there. But there was one person responsible for all transfer to rescue, all volunteer programs, all foster programs, social media, one person. In DeKalb, there were actually two people, but those same people were responsible for adoptions as well. So the very first thing was to look at that and start to invest in the programs that are make up the no-kill equation, but that you've all heard about, open adoptions, fostering, all those programs. Social media has been a really big thing for us as well. I think we really had to put ourselves on the map because no one knew these shelters existed in the Atlanta area. So we put a lot of effort into marketing, and that has helped us a lot as well.
So maybe we can take a minute to give a huge round of applause to these incredible people. So you're in these situations where it seems truly hopeless, and you have to pick a starting point. And I'm guessing that for many of you, resources were an issue. You didn't have enough resources. So how did you, despite not having enough money, start saving more lives?
Shocker, I'm the first one to ask for money. You know, something that costs no money is a story that you tell yourself about yourself and the way the community perceives you. And I think one of the first things we had to do was really realize that the narrative we're the dog pound to the community, and we're killers. And the more we perpetuated that belief system, the more it happened. And so it really started with changing the narrative that we told ourselves, because that starts changing the culture, and that actually costs nothing. And so that's kind of like, I know you guys have some other stuff, but I always like to offer like the things that don't cost anything, and that was one of them for us.
Yeah, and I'll just say from our perspective, and this goes a little bit to what Rebecca was referring to earlier, you know, we knew that we weren't going to be no-kill right away. I mean, we knew 94, 95% wasn't a likelihood for us in our first year. And yet every decision we made was a decision that we made under the assumption that that animal was going to live. So we went ahead and vaccinated every animal on intake, even though it cost us more money on the front end, because we were investing in things that were going to create a positive outcome for the animal. And I strongly believe that if you invest in the idea that that animal is going to have a live outcome versus investing in the idea that they're not, you're going to get the result you invest in. And so I'm a big believer in, like, treat every animal that comes in as if it's going to have a positive outcome. And the more that you can do that, the more you kind of change that narrative to yourself of, like, we're doing what we can to save those animals' lives.
So for me, in the small city that I worked in, it actually is not very far from Austin, and it is actually one of the poorest counties in the state of Texas. So it's a big difference between Austin here, even Williamson County in there. So there were no resources. I mean, the animal shelter was the low man on the totem pole when it came to budget. So with our group, the 501c3, we just raised money in the community. And we, of course, back then there wasn't social media, so we had to rely on the local newspaper, which is more popular before social media came along. And we did a lot of adoption events that didn't cost us any money, like at the local Walmart, where there were a lot of people that shopped, and then you get the word out that way. So you just have to start a grassroots effort and then build from there. We eventually, within the first year, raised enough money to be able to buy vaccinations and all the medications the animals needed at the shelter. And I also had an ad in the Austin American Statesman every week for adoptions for those animals, because nobody even had a clue that that place existed. So a lot of our adoptions actually came from Travis County.
People were our most valuable resource because we didn't have any money. We had a $30,000 budget and 850 animals coming in every month or every year. So, almost.
It felt all like just it. Like,
I don't like it right now. But,
okay, he wins.
Right. But, and really, by the time you take the electric bill and all that other stuff out of there, it really left you with about $19,000 to do things at the shelter, and all that was cleaning supplies and building maintenance and air filters for the air conditioner. So there wasn't any money set aside for the animals. It was to keep the building open. So our volunteers are who moved mountains and did the adoption events and went out and raised money and found donors and put the word out that we were having adoption events using social media. Unlike the carrier pigeons that Cheryl had. There was all kinds of hurdles. Every day there was another something that we had to figure out. And we just figured out how to get over, around, or through it every day. And eventually got where we wanted to be.
Does that ever stop, the hurdles?
No, it's still today.
And I think it's the same. Resources are always an issue, and they're always going to be an issue. I think really what's been important for us is how resourceful can we be? How can you leverage whatever it is that you do have, whether it's a volunteer group or the newspaper or adoption promotions? Word of mouth works just as good as anything else, really, I think. But it was really prioritizing what we needed to do first and what Brett said is really important, getting the staff, getting everyone on board to begin to think the minute an animal comes in, that animal's going to have a live outcome, and focusing your effort that way, that was really important for us in the beginning.
If you could go back now and give your 40%, 30%, 50% self a piece of advice, what would you tell that leader in that moment? Like, what would you tell them? Would they do anything differently?
I would be transparent sooner. I think for me, it was, so you have this idea that you're the killer and the community thinks you're the killer in the pound. And so being upfront about your data is something that is not a national inclination to do. But knowing what I know now is that the community can't help solve a problem that they don't know about. And so, and there's a way you can tell your story that also doesn't demonize you or the staff members who are trying and who are doing really great work. We learned that lesson at like the 60, 70% mark, and I wish we would have learned that sooner. We would have saved a lot more lives.
You know, and I think for us, and I kind of had the same situation as Cheryl and Carl up here, is, you know, we took over a animal shelter contract and had never run a shelter before, had not really even run a rescue before. We fostered a couple of dogs, but that was about it. And so I think if I were to go tell myself again to what to do, it would be to focus on the culture first. I think we were really hung up on hiring people with animal welfare experience, and all of them had the wrong type of experience that had been in the same cycle, when the reality was all we had to do is reach out to other people in other communities to learn what we needed to learn. So we could learn the animal welfare knowledge that we needed. What we couldn't teach was culture. And so we had to hire culture and then teach animal welfare, not vice versa.
You have to hire people with compassion and not necessarily the experience. So you have to measure what their compassion is and are they in it for the right reason. But if I had to give advice to somebody that was going to start in this, is my advice would be keep an open mind. Try everything and anything. And if it doesn't work, move on. If it works, then you just created another program.
So the question was, what would I do differently? Or would I tell somebody? You know, I think one of the things that made the biggest difference for us, and it also has to do with culture, is to really push the open adoptions right away, get people on board with that, and be mindful of staff that aren't, well, that are basically turning adopters away. If you don't have if you're not doing open adoptions, you don't have a welcoming adoption environment, and you may not be able to have that in a crappy shelter. So the only way to compensate for that is with customer service and people going the extra mile from visitors coming to the shelter. So I think I would have emphasized that much earlier and been more, strict is the right word, but we really have to work every day still to keep that in our culture.
So it's been striking to me how much this conference already, people have come up, the people that work for us. How do you transition an employee who has normalized killing, who is a euthanasia tech, how do you transition them into life-saving? How did you accomplish that?
So this is a pattern here, here, and then it goes that way. It's what we've now established a pattern. That's a really tough question because that's something I had to reconcile for myself. Something that I believe is a shelter system will build you or break you. You have to first have the self-awareness to decide what you want it to be. So for myself, I had to make that choice of I don't want to be shut down, broken down, and hate people and just be shut off and be able to kill 100 animals a day. How do I use this to build myself? And then when I was in the position to have team members and be responsible for people, it was really helping them reconcile with the shame that they were dealing with, because those of us who worked in those systems convinced ourselves that what we were doing is necessary. And so when someone comes at you and with a new idea, a new practice, a new philosophy that goes against that, that's a really hard thing, which is why personally when I go into shelters where there's a really high kill rate, I approach it with curiosity, the quest for information free of judgment, because I'm not trying to judge them right away. just kidding. So it's really helping, being supportive of the team, explaining the why, letting them know that they have to somehow reconcile what they've done, but they can't let that be the thing that holds them back from moving forward. And then I'm a big believer if people can't move forward, then it's my job to also release them from the job, and because they're not serving themselves anymore either. So I'm a believer of helping facilitate that process.
Helping facilitate that process.
I help facilitate the exit process.
And I'll echo that last part of it, because we hired originally an executive director at Kansas City Pet Project who had a great background in animal welfare. And we parted ways with her after 4 months, because it quickly became clear that her background was in the way of the life-saving that we wanted to do. And so we facilitated a mutual agreement.
Sometimes they don't know it yet.
and so it ended up, like, sometimes if they aren't willing to change and change needs to happen, then you've got to let them go, and you can't be afraid to do that. It's going to be in the best interest of all parties long term.
I didn't have that experience because we didn't have anybody to begin with. One of the shelter attendants quit when he realized the police department was going to be running it. And the other shelter attendant we almost arrested because she was doing illegal things in the shelter. So when they sent Brenda and I down there, we had a police mindset. So when we hire somebody, we're going to dig and really just, you know, beat them over the head, basically. But we went, anytime we hired somebody else, it was, this is our philosophy, this is what has to be done in order to accomplish that, and this is what you're going to have to do. And if that's not your cup of tea, then move down the road.
Yeah, I don't know if I have much to add. I mean, we inherited a number of employees. We didn't have to hire them, but we did need staff, so we did hire them. Because, like, we didn't run animal control previous to that. We had spay-neuter clinics. I think that, you know, we did try to leverage the talents, and still today try to leverage talents of people who have that experience of working with animals. Even if the animals didn't survive the shelter experience. And we have some really talented people that were worked in the shelter when it had a 90% kill rate. Others just, you know, they didn't fit. For some people couldn't make the transition. There were, I think if you have a shelter that has some resources, and we certainly had some resources. I don't think they're adequate, but we had some resources. We have a shelter that has some resources and is doing really badly. There are probably some people there that are doing really badly, and they're going to have to go. And, you know, we had some animal control officers that seemed to have some sort of business on the side where they sold the animals off the truck. And
that's why we almost arrested one.
Exactly, yeah. But, you know, there are things like that happening. Our shelter director came from another state, I want to say another country, but it's another state, and they had a distemper outbreak in her jurisdiction, and they had to really crack down on the animal control officers selling roadkill and wildlife off the trucks. And I'm like, well, it's better than that. So, but
thank you. So on to the animals. You have a shelter where animals are indiscriminately dying, really, I think, probably at the numbers you were at, regardless of their identity, of what exactly they were. How did you start with data? Did you start to save particular groups first, or did you just start to try to kill fewer animals?
There was no data. So, no, we just tried to save the animals. I mean, I didn't even care what they were. We just tried to save them. And provide a better life for them at the shelter than what they had. Literally, they were washing down open wire crates with kittens hanging off the side and washing down the kennels with the kittens in there. And yes, the animal control officer was stealing dogs and selling them to somebody else because that's what they wanted. So he would take orders and go steal them. And he was doing drugs off the truck. So yeah, such a culture. But yeah, there was no data, so you have to just start somewhere. Yeah,
we didn't have data either. We everything was like on handwritten kennel cards. So there was someone who I think would put things in a spreadsheet, but they worked for the part of the county that none of us had access to. But what we did have when I first started was a pit bull policy that any pit bull type dog that was identified as such from the shelter staff over the age of 3 months was automatically killed. And so you don't need data to know that that's the first thing you need to start to tackle. And so that was actually, in the first year that I was there, a lot of us got together, the euthanasia technicians, and we were like, we need to convince the shelter manager at the time that we shouldn't do this. So we convinced her that it was her idea to change that. And so that was one of the things that instantly switched up our adoption. We had more animals that were even available to go up for adoption. And I'm talking like highly adoptable puppies that, of course, we know that most of them weren't even pit bull puppies. A lot of them were all these other things, but I mean, talking thousands of animals with just one simple distinction change.
And so I think for us in Kansas City, so where I said earlier, we made the distinction that we were going to treat every animal as if it was going to live. The caveat would be, we decided early on that we were going to save healthy and minorly treatable animals first. And so there are things like parvo that we didn't start off trying to treat. We were honest with ourselves and said, you know what, parvo, distemper, we don't have the resources for that right now. We have plenty of healthy animals that are dying around here. Let's focus our energies on the ones that we know are easily savable. And so in some ways we made some euthanasia decisions a lot faster on some of that versus trying to treat some animals that had been hit by cars and such. But it allowed us to use what limited resources we had to really invest on the healthy animals so that we could get our live release rate numbers up, so we could tell the public what good work we were doing, and then ask the public for more support, because it's like, if you give us more money, we can then treat parvo. Or if you give us more money, we can then invest in a playgroup program to help these behaviorally challenged dogs. But we had to have the success story first to give credibility, because as we all said, we were starting from a situation where we had a horrible cloud hanging over the shelter and everybody was expecting us to fail. So my one caveat is we did focus our resources on those healthy ones first. And keeping them healthy.
And I just wanted to add, we, in one of our counties, we looked at the law, and there was nothing in the law that prohibited free-roaming cats. And in fact, the ordinance kind of looked like it was written by cats. You have to do all this, you know, on your property, leash, identification, blah, 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 except cats. And there were like four or five paragraphs that said, except cats. Well, except cats. So we immediately stopped picking up cats. We just told people there's nothing that prohibits free roaming cats in Fulton County. Is the cat injured? And they're like, no. I'm like, well, good to go. And immediately put in a shelter near return program. And that, to me, there's no reason that we should be euthanizing cats in shelters. That there's such an easy solution. So. One is to look at the law and see if you really do need to be doing what you're doing with cats. And then if you do, work to get that law changed, because that's the quickest way to increase your live release rate is stop picking up feral cats and killing them.
I think that's
okay. So I have to tell a really quick story about Jose.
Oh,
because I inherited his shelter.
Sorry.
So he did two crazy things. One, he took, they were gonna have to kill a bunch of dogs for space because there was not a lot of space, and he erected a giant, and I'm not kidding you, circus tent that houses 150 or more dogs that has, we've calculated, saved more than 20,000 lives in the last 4 years.
I have a lot of ulcers because of that damn tent, by
the
way.
It's horrifying, it's still up. Number two, my first week there, I walk into the dead body cooler expecting to find a bunch of dead bodies. Instead, I found parvo puppies. He took the dead body cooler, which he no longer needed because they weren't killing so many animals, and turned it into a parvo word for puppies.
It's a really eerie thing. When we first pitched it, we were like,
Yeah, right? Like, it's not ideal. And I'm bringing up these stories for a reason. It saved so many lives, though, even though it was kind of awful. And so my question to you is, what's the craziest, wildest, most innovative thing you've done in desperation to save animals?
I'm just thinking of some of them.
Is there one more than those two?
No, but we fake killed animals all the time.
You fake killed them?
So we had a veterinarian at the time who, I'll explain it. So we had a veterinarian at the time when I started who basically, she wasn't the director, but anything she said went. And her practices were not in alignment with life-saving. They were very fear-based. They were very anti-community, anti-rescue. You know, anything she couldn't control, it wasn't happening then. So she would keep really tight logs of the euthanasia solution, the euthasol. So we realized that. So what we started to do was when animals would come in that we thought should be saved, we would mark them, we would pull the solution out, pour it down the drain, write that we gave it, and send the dog out the back door to a rescue. All the time.
Oh, I got nothing.
Okay. Come on, you guys. I know you have stories.
Brenda's got some.
Well, and I shared this earlier, but for anybody who missed it, you know, our Parvo Award ended up starting, because I hear it a lot, like, we don't have the space to treat Parvo, and so I'm laughing about your treating Parvo dogs in the cooler, where the dead animals were supposed to be. So when we got a couple of Parvo dogs in late after our first year, and our basically director of operations said, you know what, we're not going to kill these dogs today. And she was officing in a former locker room. It was actually the women's locker room in the animal control part of the building. So it really only had like a shower and like a couple of lockers, whereas the men's was like a whole bunch of stuff because that's the way animal control was when that building was designed in 1972. So she was officing in the locker room and basically picked up her desk and her computer and all of her stuff and threw it all out in the hallway. And rolled a bank of kennels into this room because she knew she had a water source and she could make it into a Parvo ward. And so basically started a Parvo ward and set up her office out in the hallway, which caused a lot of great conversations with the fire marshal, but we got through it. And so, yeah, it was basically just deciding, you know what, my office is now the Parvo ward.
Actually, about the Parvo ward at PAC, and this is kind of what ties into what really helps save animals, that was not my idea. That was the idea of our medical operations manager, Michelle Figueroa, at the time, and she still works for Kristen now. Part of what my job was to say yes, and finding ways to say yes, not only to the staff's ideas, but to the community's idea, and to rescue people that we worked with, and which is not easy, because sometimes you want to have control over things, but no one person can control everything. And so as we moved forward, just saying yes, and I feel like our job in leadership roles is to say yes as often as possible.
I still got nothing.
I mean, we did the same thing. We converted offices into a Parvo and another office into a kitten nursery. We did. We got a double wide trailer for that clinic. Had another one of the shelters had a classroom. And we converted that, but it had no clinic, so we had to convert the classroom into a clinic. And we got some grief over it. We got, you know, oh, they're stuffing animals in closets, and they're putting animals everywhere. Well, yeah, we were. Still do. We grew cows. One of our shelters was built to hold 80 animals originally, and our intake is 8,000, so, you know, kind of do the math. So we group house, and we group house large dogs with big heads, up to 8 to a run.
Enrichment.
It's enrichment. I did a thing with Amy Sadler earlier today on big dogs. She was talking about playgroups, and she's like, your shelters are so awesome because you have built-in playgroups. Awesome.
And one thing that I'm going to add, and this goes back to like the hiring the right people and Jose's thing of like, if you hire the right people, then your job is to say yes. You know, one of the things that we say at Casey's Pet Project a lot, and Alan can testify to this, is we use the phrase solutions, not excuses. You know, we're in a 45-year-old shelter building, and there are a lot of excuses for why things can't happen. And we just sort of like, you know, if we get ourselves in the mindset of making an excuse why we can't do it, then there will always be a reason why we can't do it. And so our focus has always been from really day one is like, okay, let's quit making excuses and let's find a solution for it. And when you take yourself out of that reasons why you can't and figure out how you can, it opens up a lot of doors for you.
So I learned about you, Brent, from reading your blog. Brent like started writing this blog where he just started saying everything, talking about their struggles, their challenges, what they were dealing with, and it was really hard stuff he was talking about. And I thought at the time reading it, isn't he afraid? Isn't he afraid to be that open and transparent? So this is my last question because I want to give them plenty of time, but were you all afraid to talk to the public, to talk to your community and be really, truly honest with them about what you were dealing with?
I will say we never were. Because while obviously all the animals came to us because of some breakdown in the public somewhere else, we also knew that the public was going to be who was going to bail us out of it. And I always felt like that being open and transparent and honest about what our needs were was going to allow the public to come forward. And I will say that the scaredest I ever was after our first year, we were dedicated to full transparency and we were getting ready to publish our first year numbers. I also will say that I'm not a big fan of just publishing numbers and I'm like, here, have them. Like, I want to do the interpretation for them. Like, I wanted to say, we doubled the number of adoptions. We're really proud of that. But here are the places where we still have work to do. And we had a really scary number on there, and it was the number of animals that died in care. Now, keep in mind that right before we took over the contract, the prior contractor had been booted out because animals were dying untreated in kennels. And volunteers had taken photos of it and turned them into the Department of Agriculture. And so we had like 180 animals that died in care, and I'm like, crap, that's a lot. Okay, so I looked into the data, and most of them were neonatal kittens, and over half of them had died in foster care. So we had done a lot of things right, but they were dying in foster. So we essentially published the number and said, okay, and we want to highlight this. We had lost 180 animals that died in care. We want you to know that these are neonatal kittens. They're very fragile. Most of them died in foster homes, so we have some work to do. And one of our volunteers, one of our kitten fosters, like, came forward and she's like, you know what I do? She's like, I weigh them all on my kitchen scale. Because by the time you notice, just like by picking them up, that they're losing weight, it's too late. She's like, but if you weigh them on a kitchen scale twice a day, you can start seeing if one of them's not getting enough food and that weight's coming off of her. And I was like, holy crap, kitchen scales are cheap. So we bought 20 kitchen scales, cost us about $200. Even to all of our kitten fosters, and then all of a sudden we cut that number in half the next year. And so it was like it was the scariest thing that we ever did, and then somebody stepped forward with a solution to the problem that may never have manifested itself had we not done it, which just further reinforced the like need for embracing the transparency and the public thing. So that's why I never got scared of it, because every time that we would publish something in honesty, people would know that we weren't hiding anything.
I'll only say one thing is you shouldn't be scared of your community. You shouldn't be scared of your transparency because you need that. In fact, you need to build a relationship with your media and your community so they know what a great organization you are. And so when a mistake is made, they're not going to kill you for it. You're not going to be crucified for it. They're going to understand, yes, you made a mistake. I'm owning up to that mistake. And we will move on from here and we've taken these steps to correct it. If you don't have that relationship with them first, they will crucify you.
Mm-hmm. Cheryl, you also are a person who, when you have a space crisis, you are honest and you let people know that animals are at risk of dying for space. Is that scary? Because that sounds really hard.
It is hard to do that. And, you know, I Facebook is, like I said in one of my meetings, that it can be your best friend and it can be your worst enemy. And it's my worst enemy because I see animals listed on there from other places, this animal's dying today. This, you know, these are all on the euthanasia list, and it kills me because I want to pull them, and I'm an open mission shelter, and I still go, okay, I'll take that animal. So, but when we get in a crisis, if we have tried everything, if we've done free adoptions, we've pled to the public, we've done everything we can on Facebook, and we're still not getting the results we need to get animals out of there, and we're in a space crunch, then yes, I will say, if we don't get 100 animals out of here this weekend, I did that this year with cats. We were 300 cats and kittens in our shelter. 100 of them were in crates. I said, if I don't get, and we tried for a month to get the public to respond. And so I said, if we don't get 100 cats out of here this weekend, we will have to make some hard decisions. And they're a dollar to adopt. Oh, and they weren't even free, they were a dollar. And we ran out of adoptable cats the second day. We couldn't even work up cats fast enough to get them in. We adopted out over almost 200 cats. And then the second day, we were like, hey, the dogs want to join in the fun. out there, and we adopted out a whole bunch of dogs, too. You have to be careful with that message. If you do it all the time, you will not be taken seriously. But if you are in a crisis and you have to do it, it will yield you results. But you have to be careful of the message. Don't cry wolf.
As to transparency, we publish our statistics every month. Everything's an open book. Anybody can come look. That's all I have to say about transparency. We just celebrate everything, even minor victories on social media. Just the littlest things, and it just keeps you out there.
Yeah, I don't know. We try to have integrity. I try, if, like you said, we're not perfect, we do something wrong, we own up to it. The movement is so contentious. I'm sitting here, I'm trying to pay attention, but my phone is blowing up because I think someone's trashing us on Facebook. Y'all cannot go and see what it is. I don't really know what it is right now, but that's what usually happens when it's either let's see what's happening. So that makes it hard. I mean, it really is. It's constant criticism, and that does make it difficult. So we work to be transparent. We work to have some integrity. I have to constantly say, don't lie, don't make stuff up, tell the truth. But it really is. It's difficult. I mentioned to you earlier, we're being sued for an animal that two dogs escaped their home. There was no, we've never been called on these dogs before, and there's no previous anything, and they didn't come from our shelter. They were just owned dogs, and they escaped from their home, and within about 30 minutes had attacked a group of children at a bus stop and killed one of the children, and seriously injured another one. And this happened a year ago, a group of advocates that have always been very, very critical of us, whether it was true or not, hooked up with the plaintiff's attorneys, and now we're being sued. And they're, without trying litigating the case here or anywhere, just from a standpoint of, if we're going to be responsible for every stray dog, that makes it impossible to do anything. So it's hard. It's not for the faint of heart. And transparency is, it's easier said than done.
And I just want to say one other quick thing on the transparency before I almost fell on the floor. But one of the things on transparency is, one of the reasons I wrote the blog and one of the things that we shared a lot of information via social media wasn't for the general public as much as it was for our core group of volunteers, because they were hearing some of the things, and if we were giving them the information about what was really going on, they were better equipped to go out and defend us. And so for 6 months, I spent every morning, I would get up out of bed and I'm like, oh, what crap did somebody say about us now? And then it would be like, oh, now I'm up out of bed and somebody said something horrible, and like four of our volunteers have already beaten the snot out of them on social media. And I'm like, all right, my work's here done. I'll see you again the next day. And so it really helped arm them with the information they needed, because I'm a big fan of giving those people who support you the tools that they need to support. And it's the old Casey Stengel thing of, one of the secrets to good management is keep the players that hate you away from the people who are undecided. And so, we just wanted to be sure that we ruled out the undecided and brought them over onto our side with our volunteers being able to support them.
Thank you. So having plenty of time for questions means 0 minutes. So yay us. But it's been a really amazing 50 minutes. It's actually really incredibly inspiring to hear all of you talk. Anyone who wants to ask questions can ask them at the end. Actually, we're going to go ahead and wrap up, and if you want to come up, the speakers will stay for about 2 minutes. So you can come on up. But thank you, thank you, thank you for everything.